So today we're going to talk about MS Build, and we're going to explore the many options in MS Build, and we're going to try some of the programs as well, and see how MS Build can help us in automate our build infrastructure. So let's get started. So what I'm going to use is I'm going to use the Notepad. And that way I'm going to explain it to you what exactly the MS Build is. So first thing, what is MS Build? MS Build is a build automation tool. MS Build is a build automation tool. Which help us to automate all the repetitive tasks in our build infrastructure. Okay, it is from Microsoft. It is free. It is built with Windows platform. You can use MS Build with command line using command line. You can use in the Visual Studio. You can use the MS Build in TFS as well. Okay. So basically, this is a tool which can help us to automate our build infrastructure. Now, why do we need MS Build? To answer this question, we need to understand. Let me save this page. We need to understand what are the build infrastructure automation we are going to automate with. So I would like you to get your points about what exactly you need to automate in the build infrastructure. Can you share some of the points with me? Any points? Okay, so once we start the source code, let me help you to understand. Once we have a source code which is written by developer from developer and got pushed to source code management tool, and that is in our case we are using Git, then we have to compile the source code into the binary. Okay. And conversion from the source code to the binary is not an easy task because we have to do many procedures for that. So one of the procedures, like, we need to create a directory structure, create a directory create directory structure. We do have to copy the source code. We do have to set the properties or configuration. Set the n number of properties and configuration. We do have to copy the dependencies to our build environment. And you know that nowadays we have many external dependencies, like some programmers are using some external libraries in their code, and we do have some internal dependencies as well. And internal dependencies like module 1 is dependent on module 2 is dependent on module X, like this. So copy the dependencies, and then top of it we set the things like compiler. Okay, so we do hell lot of stuff, from the creating a directory, copying the source code, setting the properties and configuration, making sure the dependent library is being copied in build environment, set the compiler, and then we do the compilation, compile, probably package, and etc. And then top of that, we do all these activities probably 30 times in a day. So we do all these activities 30 times in a day, so we cannot do manually. If you do manually, it's going to take a lot of time. Sometime you do in night, sometime we do in daytime, sometime we do in morning. So there's a feature which things which you cannot sit and do all this stuff. So we need automation. We have to automate all these tasks because we cannot do manually. And once we need automation, then we need tools for it. And this is all these things are related to the build infrastructure. So we do, in order to convert the source code to the binary, we do everything. And not only we do these are the things, we do n number of other things as well, which we are not talking about, which is product specific. These are the high level requirements. So now we look for the automation. So we would like to automate this task, and we look for the tools. Now you have so many tools or so many programming languages and so many scripting languages which is available. So we have a tools, we have a programming languages, let's say, which can help you to automate, which is like Perl, Python. You can use C++ also, if you can use Java also for the automating all these tasks. But we are not using these languages. Why? Because it is not easy to learn. Easy to write. Easy to modify. Easy to change. Easy to extend. And easy to share. Okay, these languages, Perl, Python, C++, and Java, these are programming languages, and sometimes we can use to scripting. We can still automate using these languages of all these tasks, but we do not use it because it is not easy to learn. It takes time to learn. It takes time to write, test, debug, and all that. It's not easy to change very frequently, because for one number of changes you have to try again everything, whole things, And you, it's not easy to extend, it's not easy to share with the other people also, because if you share this code, he also need to stand Perl, the whole programming languages as well. So this is not easy to do that. Still you can do that, use it, but we do not use it. And we need some tool which is very easy to learn, which is very easy to write, very easy to change, very, which is very easy to extend, easy to share. And which tool can serve all of my purpose. So now we have a many build tools available with us, starting from the Ant, Maven, MS Build, Gradle, Groovy, and many more. Okay, so we have so many tools available which can automate all this sort of task easily, which is easy to learn, easy to write, easy to change, easy to extend, and easy to share. Now you must be thinking, why we are not using only one tool? So basically this tool is designed specific to the platform. So Ant is designed for the Java related project. Anant is designed for the .NET based platform. Maven is designed for the Java. MS Build again designed for the .NET, Microsoft related, let's say MS, that's a better word. Okay, Gradle has been designed for the Groovy related programming languages. Okay, so can we use Maven for the MS world, sorry, Microsoft technology or .NET? Can we use Anant for the Microsoft, or can we use MS Build for the Java? Yes, we can use it. But again, we are talking about the automation, and we are selecting the tools. And why do we need a tools? Why need a tools? Because we want to save our time. That's the only thing we use a tool for it. So if you use MS Build for the Java, again you're going to spend more time on it, because Maven and Ant is having lots of inbuilt functionality which can easily automate the build automation of the Java, and which will save your time. So that is the reason we use the dedicated languages, a dedicated tool for the dedicated programming languages. Okay, so till now what we understand, we try to understand what is MS Build, and then we try to understand why do we need a MS Build, and then we figure it out what are the other build tools we have it, and why we are learning MS Build, because MS Build is a build automation tool for the Microsoft technology, which includes .NET, C++, and many more. Okay, any questions do we have till now? Any questions?
Rajesh, is TFS a build tool or it's a SCM, source control engine?
Okay, so there's one question is, TFS is build tool or what? Basically, TFS is a lifecycle management tool. So, lifecycle management tool. It has a many functionality, starting from the source code management, build management, incident management, planning, test, and release. So all these things, okay, we sometimes also call application lifecycle management. Okay, so TFS has many features in it, okay, and it does lots of things. So source code management, you can use the inbuilt TFS, or you can also use the Git build, you can use MS Build, incident, they have inbuilt tools, planning, they have inbuilt tools. You can integrate the TFS test with any tools and release. So it's basically application lifecycle management tool, not a build tool. Okay.
Okay. Correct.
Any other question?
And reporting as well.
Hello.
Reporting as well. You can use reporting as well, right, in TFS.
Yeah. So again, release and report is like some.
Same. Okay.
Any other question? Okay. Now I am going to discuss about how can you install MS Build. So MS Build already you will get installed in Visual Studio. Okay, you do not install. If you are using Visual Studio, that means is it inbuilt. But if you are using MS Build with the command line like DOS prompt or something like that, you have to install. So what you need to do in order to install the MS Build in the command line, you have to look for the your .NET, look for the .NET based directory for the .NET based directory, and then locate the msbuild.exe and set in the path. Okay. So this I have done it for you. I am going to show it to you. So I go to my properties, advanced properties, environment variable, path, and if you look at my path here, which is having long lines, I'm going to locate it, the my snippet of the code, and which is here. If you look at it, this path which I have selected, that is my MS Build path. So this place, if I show you here, you have a msbuild.exe file. Here it is. So this path you have to add into the path value, and that is the way it gets installed. Okay, I hope it is clear. So now I have done the installation using the same way. Now how do we verify? How do we verify MS Build is installed or not? So we go to the command prompt and type MS Build, and now it says Microsoft Build Engine version 4.6 dot something is installed. .NET framework also is giving 4.0, and it's basically look for the MS Build file, which is our solutions file, but it is not found, but at least we can verify. If you want to know exact version, this is the command which will give you. Okay. And if you want to do the health, then it will, you want to type it health, and these are the options you have for the MS Build. You can see it. Hyphen V will not work, so be mindful about it. Probably you have to do the version or something. So let me verify. Yeah, you have to do the version. Here it is. So your MS Build is 4.6, .NET version is 4.0. So simple. How to verify? Over the command prompt, MS Build hyphen version, and over the command prompt, MS Build hyphen health to see the number of parameters. Okay. Now we did installed and we did verify. Now we have to write a programs. Okay. So how we have to write a program. So how do we write a program? We write a program. So if you remember, and if you it look further, let me put it, let me clear the screen and let me type the MS Build one more. Now if you remember the error message, it states error MSB1003, specify a project or solution file. So MS Build needs a input as a MS Build project file, which we can create it, or solution file, which we can get it using the Microsoft Visual Studio. Remember, if you have worked with the Visual Studio, you create a basically solution file. Okay, you work on the project, it's create a solution file. So either you can pass the solution file, and solution file is again as a MS Build file. Okay, so if you open any solution file, it will be having the MS Build elements itself, or you want to write a project. So basically, I'm not having Visual Studio for time being. I'm going to use a project. Basically, I'm going to write a script for it. So before writing a program, you're going to write a program. Let's understand how do we compile. So basically, you store the file, store the changes, store the changes in .ms build file. So that means you name it whatever file name you wanted, file name .ms build, store the changes in the file file name that is called ending with the ms build extension. Usually you store in default dot ms build. Okay, so all the changes we store, how to store the ms build. Okay, now next question is, once we have written the program in and saved in the file, then how do we compile it? So just normally we type ms build and then file. That's all. Okay, again, let me talk about the how do we compile the target, because we have not written any programs till now. So I'm going to come back again on this section and I'm going to help you to other stuff. So till now, how do you store the MS build file? You store with the MS build extension. How do you compile it? So you just type MS build and build file. Okay. Now the next question, which is important question, is we want to write a program. How do we write a program? Okay. So now, in order to understand the how do we write a program, you need to understand basic building blocks. Okay, so before that, I would like you to proceed further on the PPT, so because that way I'll make sure that I'm not missing any things important. Okay, so I discuss about MS Build. In this module, we'll talk about the MS Build project file, target, task, and properties. And this is the how MS Build works, which I have explained it to you. If you look at the images, MS Build XML file talks to the MS Build.exe, and it can, you can talk, you can use the msbuild.exe through command line, Visual Studio, and TFS. These are the some of the histories what MS Build was released, and currently we are using the .NET build platform, which is 4.0. Okay, and how can you install the MS Build, which you did talked about it, and how do we start writing a program? So basically, the writing a program is nothing but the project element, target element, property group, and item group, and tasks, and five things. So let's get started from here. Okay, so I have not missed anything, that's for sure. So now we need to start writing a program. So in order to understand the program structure, you need to understand few basic building blocks. And the few basic building blocks is project, target, let me put it in the here, project, target, property group, item group, and last one is tasks. If you understand all these five elements and five building blocks, you can write any sort of MS Build program without any other help. So these are the building blocks you have. So let me tell you, XML, MS Build script is based on the XML file. Okay. So basically, MS Build, whenever you write default.ms build or file name.ms build, you basically write XML. And you know that what exactly XML contains. XML contains the elements. And in MS Build, there are defined elements. And elements, these elements are, we call it in MS Build, are project, target, property group, item groups, and tasks. So whenever you write any project, okay, so here if you remember, again I am going to command console, specify a project or solution file. That means I am going to specify a project. So let's say you are going to automate a task. Let me close this. You are going to automate a building process. Requirement is automating a build process for softex. Okay, so your project name will become a softex. Maximum elements what you can have in your XML file is one. You cannot have more than one element, project element, in your project file, program files. Now, what is the target? So what is the property group and what are the item groups? So let me talk about the property group. So you can define properties, like every time we define a variable and their values, we define the property and their values, we define the attributes and their values. So every program is a way to define the properties. And in MS World, in MS World, we say property, we define the property inside the property group. And you can define the properties as many you wanted. So you can define the properties as many wanted, and that's a multiple. Okay, again, same concept goes with the item groups. As of now, I'm going to skip it, item group, due to lack of time. Okay, now what is the tasks? Now if you remember, here I do, in terms of automating the build infrastructure, I do a hell lot of things. Creating appropriate directory structure, copying the source code, set the properties, copy the dependencies, set the compiler, clean compile package. We do all this stuff. So basically, tasks is nothing but an inbuilt function in MS Build, which was designed to help our build activities, build automation activity. And what is the build automation activity? These are the things like creating a directory structure, copying the things, compiling, cleaning, packaging, and all this stuff. So these are the things which is a task. Some of the example tasks are copy, delete, and create a directory. So I think create directories, I need to refer it one more time. Okay, so these are the kind of tasks we have it. So these tasks are inbuilt. Okay, these tasks are inbuilt in MS Build. So we're going to use this task. Okay, and then these tasks are nothing but to do in order to do all this. So I'm going to show you the list of tasks which we have in MS Build and which will help you to automate the task. So now you understand about the tasks, you understand about the property group, you understand about the project which is going to be having one. Now if you put it multiple tasks together in certain blocks, then you call it a target. So basically target is nothing but a block. If you have a, if you have done a programming, you put it n number of snippet of the code inside some block, and that you call it for a specific person, a purpose. So something like a method or function. Okay. So it's like that. You put it n number of tasks together and you want to name it with some specification. So you can call it only that particular task. So the, in MS Build, you have to put it in the target. So target, you can have it as many you want, multiple. Okay. So till now, what we discussed, like in order to write a MS Build program, you need to understand these five building blocks. These are the elements: project, target, property group, item group, and tasks. Okay. Now I am going to help you to automate some of the basic. I'm going to help you to write some basic MS Build programs, and in that can that case you can understand. So what I am going to do, we have discussed about the project, target, property group, and task. So now I am going to directly copy this program and explain it to you and then run it. So now here, if you look at it, in my this program, I have a XML standard. The first line is related to XML standard, which every file should be having it. Okay, let me make it bigger. Second line is project specification. So if you remember here, project elements, you can have it one. So that is the here we have it. Next thing, we have a no property, no item group. We have a tasks. And what is a task? Here is a task name is message. And what I want to do, I just want to print the this is hello world. Okay. And this message I am putting inside the target, putting inside the block, that is the name of that block is message. And that this is, we put it using the target. So you remember, target is nothing but a kind of blocks under which we put it the multiple tasks and properties, and you can keep it multiple targets. So what I am going to do, I am going to run this program. Okay. And so I am going to command line, D drive, mkdir ms build, and the session date is 15, done, ms build. And now I am going to write a program here, saving this default dot ms build. I just save the content which I copied. And now I am going to run it. So MS Build. Done. And this is the way we run it. Done. Now we have an error. So now we have to resolve the error also. So if you look at the error pattern, okay, there is a problem in my code. And the problem in the, my code is default.ms build, line number 5, 27 character number, and it says the project file could not be loaded. Invalid character is given in the line number 5, position 27. So it is giving you hints where you are basically making a mistake. So we should resolve that issues, and now we should move on. So I know that's an error, which error is here. So I'm going the typo. Now this is done. So I'm going to clear my screen. And now you see that the expected task of this program was to display the message, this is hello world. And now I did this one. And here you can see that this is a hello world. Okay. and it has successfully succeeded without any warning, without any errors. And that the target is default target. Here if you look at it, message, here is the message target. Okay, so what we have done, we have successfully executed it. So let me increase the number of tasks inside it. And this is SCM Galaxy class. This is Rajesh Kumar. You are a part of SCM Galaxy MS Build class. Done. I just modify the same program with three tasks this time. Three times I would like to print the message, and I'm going to clear the screen here, and it's going to print three times. So now this is just a very basic programs what I have written. Okay, so this is the way we compile the program, and then this is the way we write a program, and this is the way we compile. Now let me do much more than that. Now we did it. Now next question is, how do we, there's a question, let me go back to the here. If you remember, how do we compile only specific target? Because I told you I'm going to come back. So basically this is the way. You have to put the MS build space class target colon target name. So now if in this program, if you look at it, I have only one target, which is message. So basically to reproduce it and to make it a differentiation between the target, I am going to create two targets. And I am going to put these two tasks basically inside the target name, this one. I hope you can see it now better. Okay, and this I am going to call message, let's say hello, and this we call it intro. So I just want to call the message, I want to call the hello or intro. So how do we do that? So normally we write like this, MS build target, and target name is intro. So I am just going to execute the only list of tasks which is inside the intro target. So I got the command, I clear the screen, done. And there's a problem, it seems. I missed one thing, which is default.msbuild/target intro. So now you see that only intro is going to be executed. Whatever we had in hello, it's not executing at all. It's not executing at all. So only intro is giving. Now you want to change the target name to intro to hello. It will only print one line because it has only one line. Okay. Now you see this has only one line. So let me correct it. This guy also. Okay. So this is the way, if you want to execute any specific target, you do that using this way. Now let's move on to executing few more programs. So we completed this one. Now we are going to learn how do we set the properties. Now we are done with this. Let me remove this one. And now I am going to show you how do you set the properties. So if you look at it in my program here, I am setting up the one property group. okay, and I have a two property. One property is name, and the name and variable value is Homer. Another property is full name, and the value is coming from the name and then Simpson. Okay, and how can you declare that property? How can you use that property? So this is the way you can use it. Name and full name. It's very easy. This is the task. This is the property which I'm going to use. So now let me put this snippet of the code in my program and as part of the target. Okay, let me usually set the properties on the top. So now I have a three targets. One is hello, second one is intro, one is display property. So I'll just make it smaller one name, so that way it's easy to write. So I just type prop. So I am going to call only prop this time, and then you see what is going to happen. So I'm going to clear the screen, and I'm going to call only prop. And you see that the variables has been taken, property has been defined, and it displays the Homer Simpson. Okay, so this is the way we add the property in MSBuild. Now next thing is, there's a two kind of property in MSBuild. One we have it inbuilt property, and another one which we have it like we define our own property. What we did, we define our own property, but remember, whatever the Microsoft has a properties, inbuilt property, you can use those properties as well. So some of the properties you have it like build project file and build project extensions and all the stuff. So sysprop. Okay, so you can also use those properties in order to automate this stuff. So what I did, I have only two properties just for show you the demo, and I'm going to compile this program, and I'm going to clear the screen. Sysprop, and now you see your file name is default.msbuild and the extension is .msbuild. Okay, so similarly, we have a list of properties. You can get it from the Microsoft MSDN website, and you can use it in your program. Okay. Now, next thing is copying the things. Next thing is a task. So if you remember here, when I said, how do you write a program? So you have to write a program using project, target, property groups, and tasks and item group. We did talk about a project. We did use the target. We showed you. We use the property group also, and we use the task as well. And the task this time I used a message, but we are going to use some more tasks. So as part of the using some more tasks, there are a few tasks like copy task, delete task, message task, which we have used it. And if you want to know the list of other tasks, you can refer the MSDN reference for that. So copy task will copy the file from the one place to another place. Delete task will delete the files, and so and if you want to display any things, then you have to use the message task. Okay, so these are the tasks I am going to use it. You can use it and in your program and do the thing. So if you want to know some of the tasks which is already there, so let me go back to the URL. And here, if you see that, here you have a list of tasks. In the left hand side, if you look at it, these are the tasks actually. Okay, so these are the tasks, and one of the tasks which I used is message task. But here you have a task, and you can use any of these tasks based upon your requirement. So first of all, you have to convert your requirement automation into Sudoku step by step, and then accordingly you find. Here is a copy task. If you click on the copy task, now you have a why we use the copy task. You have a parameters all these parameters which you can use in the copy task. And then if you go down, you have examples also here. Okay, so here is the example. You can, if you look at it, copy file from here and put it in this direction. And this is a variable you are using, property. And where is this defined? This is defined here. So basically, you are going to copy the files, three files from this place, put it in this one. So this is the way you can use the copy task. Each command, each task, you get some example and which will help. So I'm going to show you that delete tasks. Here is the description, here is the parameter, here is the example. Look at this delete task. That means you want to delete this file, appname.pdb. Appname is coming from the my here, property. So this is the way you can use the task, copy, delete, compile. So which of the compile things you want to use it? So you want to use it for the compilation of the C# project, you're going to use the CSC tasks, which is help you to compile the program. So now if you go back directly to the examples, here it is. If you want to compile any example, so here it, you have to give the source path and you have to give the output path where after the compilation it will create a JSON. And your compile will come from the property. So this is the way you can use the task, and here you have a hell lot of tasks you can see on the screen and you can use according to your preference. Now, do we have any question? Question before proceeding.
No.
Anyone has a question? No. Okay. Now I'm going to move on to the further discussing about orders. Okay, so till now we discuss about how do we write a program, and now you know that it's easy to write a program using the tasks. And basically, if you have a requirement like copy, delete, compile, XYZ and all, you can do that very well. You can use the task, you can look for the example, you can read the each task, and you can write as many programs as many way you want. Now I am going to discuss about the PPT ways itself, and then I am going to discuss about the build target order, which is very much important in MSP. Okay, so there are four kind of target build order we have it. Target build order. One we have it, we call it initial target. Other we call it default targets. Other third one we call it depends on target, and the last one which is before targets. So what is the initial target, what is the default target, what is the depends on target, and what is the before and after? So let me show you some example. This is your program. Okay, I hope you can see it. This is a program. In it, you have a project, one element. You know that every project can have a maximum one element, and it has a one property group, and it has a multiple targets, and inside that you have a multiple one task. Each of the target has each one task. Basically, you are using the message task. Now, here we are trying to understand what is the initial target's order. So, initial target is the kind of elements. If you put it, the target inside the initial target, no matter what are the priorities you are given, initial target has to be executed. Again, I'm reiterating, the moment you define the initial target, no matter what kind of priority you have given, initial target has to be executed first. That means initial before any other target. Okay, so now if you look at it, in this program, my initial target is init one. Okay, and init one is printing something like a message text A. Okay, but in this program also, my first target which I'm mentioning in this program is step one. So the question is whether it will print the target name as step one, or whether it will print the target num in it one. So let me tell you, if you do not specify the initial target, then very fast target will be executed. But here in this case, you have put it the initial target, so it will print this way. So now if you compile the program and you are calling the target name call step one, so look at it. Here you are specifically calling the step one target, but still it is hitting the init one first and then step one. So what did we understand? Initial target, whenever you defined, it will overwrite all of your priorities, no matter whether you are putting it on the command line. Is it understood?
Yes.
Now, let me show you, what about if you put it the initial target two times, like two initial target, what will happen? So you, in this example, you have initial target init one and bt one also. So let's look at the output. In this case, again, you are calling over the command line step one. If you look at that, you are calling the step one. So step one will be overwritten, and first init one will happen, and then bt one will happen, and then step one. So this is the way, if you are, you can also set the multiple targets as part of the initial targets. Now this is the third example, and I would like you to find, give me the answer. What will be the priorities in this? So I am calling the initial targets init 1x. What will be the output of it? Can you tell me?
Init 1x.
Yeah. So what will be the output?
Just.
So if I type the target name is step one, like my MS build the my file dot targets and the step one, then what will be printing?
Init one will be first executed, right? Is that what you're asking?
No, I am asking, can you look at a program and see the initial targets, and it has init one x, and what will be the execution if I call it step one target over the command line?
I think it still execute the initial one, because your initial target, you're mentioning init one. So
no.
Can you override? Is that?
Yeah, your concept is clear, like it will, initial targets will override it. But if you look at the program, here you have initial target init one x. And if you look at your program, there's no init one x is available.
Exactly.
Yeah, so that will show you the error. So okay. This is what I wanted to hear from you.
Okay.
Okay. Now, this is what about the initial targets. That means in a nutshell, initial target will overwrite no matter whether you are passing over the command line or you are using any other targets. Now, next is the default targets. So remember, you understood about the importance of initial target. Now you can also put the default targets, and in this case we are putting the default target step 2. Okay, that means it will print 2. Okay, so now let me show you, if you compile and call the all this file without specifying any specific target, look at the first line of your command prompt. So I'm not calling any specific target. So if you just call whole files together, okay, so what will be priority? So as per the discussion, initial target has to be executed. That's called init1 and bt1. And then default targets will be taken. That's it's your step two. And rest of the things will be skipped. Okay, so that's the way the default target execute. That means default means defaults. It has to be executed, but initial target has to be respected. Okay, so that's all about the default targets. Now here you are not talking about executing any other targets, because there is no dependencies as well. Okay, we will talk about the dependency in the further slides actually. Is it understood?
Yes.
Okay, Now, next thing is, this is the program. In this, I am calling the default target, which is step 2x. Can you tell me what it will be the priorities?
Init 1 will be executed and there's no x, right? So again, I think it will throw error.
That's correct. It will show the error. Okay, so what we understood from the default targets? Default targets will be respected only after initial targets. Okay, so initial target and then default targets. Now, third thing is depends on targets. Okay, so now one target can have a dependency on other. Another targets can have a dependency on others also. So how do we resolve it? In this case, if you look at it, programs is becoming complex. Initial target is init 1. Default target is step 2. So what is my understanding is, initial target will be respected first. So init 1 will be respected first. The moment it hit to the default target, step 2, then again step 2 is dependent on step 1. So, as per the dependencies logic, step 1 has to be executed first. So, step 1 will be executed, control goes back to step 2, and then step 2 will be executed. So, this is how it happens. If you look at it, you are calling over the command line step 2. Remember, step 2. Again, step 2 is a default target. So, initial target has executed, it reached to the step 2. Step 2 is again dependent on step 1. So first step 1 will be executed and then step 2. So this is the how depends on targets work. So this is the way you can control the dependency of the each target. Make sense?
Yes.
Good. Now, here if you look at it, I have initial target that is called init 1. And default target, which is step 2. So first init 1 has to be executed and then it will be respected step 2. So again, step 2 is dependent on step 1. Okay. And so in a normal fashion, it will be done init 1 and then step 1 and step 2. Okay. But what about if you change the parameter? And look at it, the parameter here you are calling the step 3 as well. Look at it, the parameter. I'm calling the target step 3. So now the thing still, initial target has to be respected and then it will go to the default targets. So over the command line, if you remember last time, I did call the same target over the command line, which was my default targets. So that is the reason there was no confusion in it. But this time I am calling over the command line step 3. So first time initial target has to be executed, which has done. Then it is trying to default target, which is step 2. Step 2 is dependent on step 1. So step 1 has executed and then step 2 and then step 3 has been executed. That means what you understood? The priorities will be given first to the initial target, second to the default targets, and third to the command line. Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. So this is the kind of importance you have in step 3. Now, if you look at it, step 3 is again depends on step 2. So let me tell you, in a project, if one target has been executed already, then it will not repeat the stuff. Okay. So in this case, only step 2, 3 will be executed, not step 2 twice. And I would like you to tell me what will be the output of this.
Step 2 will be executed only once.
Are you sure?
First will be...
There is no step 2 actually, I guess. Depends on...
there is no step 2 here, sorry.
Yes. Yeah. So this will throw an error. So, but anyways, initial target and then default targets and then whatever you put it on the command line. So it will show an error. Now, last thing is before targets and after targets. It is little bit confusing and least used actually in MS Word. Okay. So now, if you see that the before targets, then it says step 2 before targets BT1. Step 3 after targets AT1. So let me show you the output of it. So if you look at it here, you're calling over the command line step 2. Default targets also is step 2. So that means initial target will be executed first, and that's called init1. And then default targets will be executed step 2. But before that step 2, it's saying before targets BT1. So it did not care about it because it already has a before target. The moment you put it the after target, it will be different. Okay. So before target is like if you are calling BT1, then it will execute step 2. So let me show you another one. Here it is. Look at the output of difference. Here you are calling over the command line step 2, which is again a default parameter, but another command line you are calling the BT1, and look at the flow. Okay, it is less used, but it's little bit confusion also. So if you look at it, here you are calling BT1, so first for init1, which is the initial target, and then default target, which is step 2, and then your before targets will be respected. In that case, BT1. And this is an example of the after target. One more example. And done. So what we understood, the first priorities in terms of when we are talking about the build order, the first priority will be given to the initial target. Second priority will be given to default one. Third will be given to the command line. And fourth will be given to depends on. Make sense?
Yes.
Any question?
Rajesh, I'm trying to understand here. In a real-time example, let's say I have a .NET project, okay? So how can I, like trying to picture, do we pass methods? Like initial method, we pass the method name? For example, which page, which method should be executed first? Is that the way it works?
No, I do not get your question. Can you please repeat one more time?
Oh, seriously, in a real-time example, let's say I have a .NET project, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So in this XML file, you mentioned, you know, like the way we control the build order is like
Docker project
command.
Are you talking about
the .NET? .NET.
Okay, .NET project. Okay, fine.
Yes. So let's say I'm trying to put the real-time scenario in this example. Let's say if I want to load the home page and I have a function called login, okay, and the user log into the website. So I'm expecting like in initial we pass the method name as login, right, to load the first initial method as login.
Okay, so in this, there's no as such method we call it. We have a task actually. So if you remember, I always use the terminology that is called tasks. So now what you are saying, probably you have compiled the program. Okay.
Yes.
You have compiled the program. You have an exe available and you want to call that exe and run it. Is that the right assumptions?
Yes, yes. But instead of exe, I was saying
HTML.
No. You could say HTML or let's say I have a HTML page. Okay. So for calling that HTML page, we have functions methods, right, to pull the data. So what I was thinking, you know, let's say if I have to show the landing page, home page, and my landing page consists of methods, several methods. Let's say the first method is called login, okay? So in the initial build order, do we pass the login method over there to load the login URL?
You can do so, but I think you are mixing up the things. With the tool which I am talking about is a build automation. Here you are converting your source code to binary. And the question I believe which you are asking about how to execute the test cases for a login method or something like that. So I think you should use the testing tool for it, which will help you.
Okay, sorry man. Yeah, you're right. Actually, I got confused.
Yeah. Any other question? Okay, to end with, I'm going to share some of the reference which again you have in PPTs. These are the reference which is very good, and you get the very good materials on MSDN only. Unfortunately, you won't get the materials outside of the MSDN, and so still is not very popular. And this is the task reference which I have already shown you. You can see that whichever the task you want to have a C# file, you have a C++ file, you have a solution file, you have a project file, or all these tasks you want to read it and see that if it's help you. It depends on that, like first what you do normally. First you have a requirement of automation. Okay, you convert that requirement in steps. And then you look for the task which will help you to do that requirement steps. So basically that's the way you have to complete and start doing the build automation. And once you're doing it, you have to verify it and push it on the build server and use it and like that. So this is the way you should do that. If you have any further question, you can come back to me in the next session tomorrow morning, and I will help you with that. Till then, what I want, I would like you guys to practice this as much you can, and all the sufficient resources already has been being moved to the devopschools.com, and you'll find the slides which I did used in my demo in this place. That's called MS Build, so it should be here. No, it's not here, so probably I should upload it. And anyways, I'll give you the access to all of our materials today to our Google Drive, so you'll get the access, and I'll send you the video access as well. Any further question?